we're looking to actually increase that number of volunteers. But in terms of, you know, running an event like this, it really depends on how many people we have signed up, and it's a big balancing act. So in December, it was a trip that I did not go on. They had 50 people total on this trip, and I think almost 20 of them were people with disabilities, and about half of that were people who were wheelchair bound. So when you put together a group like that, you need to figure out, well, for this person who has, you know, these types of disabilities, I need two buddies to work with them, or I need three buddies to work with them. And then you start adding on your buddies so that you have enough buddies to support all of the adaptive divers coming. So there are some adaptive divers that maybe have just cognitive disabilities, and they're actually okay diving with just one buddy. But then there's people who we actually have who dive with full face masks with quadriplegia, and they can't really do anything on their own, and those require team support. So based on the diver, we then identify the number of volunteers we need, and then we go out to our volunteer pool base. You know, I think it's all captured on Salesforce, is what we use as our CRM, and we just start soliciting volunteers who wants to join us for this trip. But these trips, they're planned pretty well in advance. We know almost all of our trips, at least in the larger land in Cozumel for this year. There might be some additional trips that get added, but last year we went to Matilla. We've got a team working in Malaysia, so now they're looking at trips even further abroad to Malaysia.
And sorry, just a real quick follow-up. Those volunteers that you have, do you have like a training program for them?
Yeah, so the training is basically all in this book, and we train people who are, we call them buddies, and we have advanced buddies, and then we have instructors. So then the instructors actually can eventually teach adaptive divers as well as teach the buddies. So it's a full, you know, you get a cert card, and then you get a certification card that you would.
Hi, good morning. Can you talk, just building on that question, can you talk a little bit about how the volunteers then build trust? I would imagine trust is a big part of taking an adaptive diver into the water. So talk a little bit about how that trust gets built up.
So we, when we first get an adaptive diver, there's something we call an NSA, which is a needed scuba assistance form. And we also have dive profile and dive space. Here's a picture of one in here. But what we have them do when they get their adaptive diver on let's say a trip or even an event that I'm doing tomorrow, we have quite a set of profile forms that they've already filled out just to get to know the diver. And so we read that prior so we have a little understanding of who we're working with. And then before we do anything like getting in the water, there's probably about, I would say, 20-30 minutes with a profile study. We go through, you know, even though we know what your scores are, we go through, okay, so how do you like to get in and out of water? And if it's your first time diving, they may not know, so you might have some suggestions on how you do that. Do you need help with, you know, safe defense in a sense? Do you need help, and how do you want that to be helped? You know, how do you want to be helped? So they're very much part of the team, and they make the decision on, you know, what help you need. I had a great diver I was working with, and he's like, I don't need you to do anything except for get me to the end of the boat, get my equipment there. And then he was a paraplegic. He was a diver before he was injured. And so if he had paddle fins, he could move around. He could move around faster than I could with his paddle fins. So he's like, I just need you to help me get on, off the boat, and back on. So every diver has different needs, and if we started coddling him and saying, you know, dragging him around, he'd be miserable, right? So it really is dependent on the diver and what the diver and their needs are.
How does it work with the volunteers
in the company? Is there a manual way, or does it? Yeah. So as a volunteer, you can raise funds, like Aaron treated exactly the same way.
So
for the participants, we've got, like, on these trips now, there's been people who've been going for years, right? So they are saving up their money and coming along. For some of our real life participants, we don't have fun fundraise. For someone who's just recently in an accident, open fundraise. Our events are all no cost though. So when we set the event, our intention, like a pool event, our intention is that that's an experience, and we don't want people to have to charge or pay to get to the door. That's why we look for donations of pool time and things like that to make that happen.
Is there, or do you currently do any coordination with different organizations that take the research that you get, or that basically that you get from the different trips or experiences? Do you work with them maybe for the sponsorship?
Oh yeah, there's grants. There's grants. And right now there's grants actually to build work on grants to build a large research facility that will be probably they're not really facilities like that are accessible to the public, like Amazon, things like that now. But so we do have grants, and some of that will go to clean trips, but that's not the intention of that one. It's really to support kind of a wider community versus the community. And that's how we do support the country. Yes.
Do you need special equipment on the boats for wheelchairs and or even diving equipment that is maybe expensive for you?
Yeah, so the dive boats need to be accessible, so they do actually have to be large enough. You can't use any dive boat where a wheelchair can actually fit on the boat. It would be great if all divers had lifts and stuff to move, the wheelchair. Some do, most don't. So we have people that we work with, and that's why we love this dive shop in Key Largo, because they're very effective actually moving people on and off boats and wheelchairs. So we have training on the best procedures to do that. So there's special lifts and cranes, but for the most part, in terms of dive equipment, the most complex one that I've seen is the whole face mask. But that's, I'm sure you've seen it, they use it in some of the amusement park and talk to you or something. Those pieces of equipment are not part of your dive gear, and maybe you should go down the mask and right later. And so those are a little bit different, difficult, can be difficult to use in the barn. But we do actually do that as part of our training, because with our quad, their passphrase themselves with the face mask, or the regulator in the mouth. Their jaw is not the strong as the regulator in the mouth, and they have to support the face mask.
So I did, if you was part, but when you work with certain diving instructors, institutions like Phil Jackson, like that, do you use them as part of maybe to get some more sponsorship?
So in this area, I've gone out to talk to some of the dive shops, but we haven't gotten that involved with them. The one that has been helping in terms of donating some equipment and tanks and stuff is involved for it. But we love working with them, and we would love to get instructors trained, and we don't do instructor training, right? So we have to find someone who's happy or SPI or SSI or NAVI or something like that and get them. Right now, that is one of, I'm a dive master, but I'm not an instructor, and I would love to get a few instructors here, because then I don't have to rely on my team members in other parts of Florida, or even fly people down. Our founder loves going to events, he's an instructor, so he shows up with people all the time, but it's not always feasible. So I would love to have our Asian instructors. That would be great.
So the obvious value added for participants is when they leave the water, do you have any follow-up success stories of people who enter your program and develop businesses or develop
stories around this are around the ability to manage their pain and being able to do a little bit. So one of the, there's quite a few material in terms of videos. We've done a couple of TED Talks, or maybe Jim, our founder, has done a couple of TED Talks about kind of the progress of some of these people who made. There's one story about a war vet who actually gained some ability to be able to feel more mobile again. So those are the types of things that we're hearing, not that you know they become a different person, but just they're able to manage their discomfort and their pain. Some children who have are born with cerebral palsy, just you know, they're very their muscles kind of spasm out, they're able to relax a little bit when they have some time in the water. So parents are seeing improvements like that. Kids with autism, the ability to actually communicate and relate better.
And I think if you could identify some direct correlation between the experience of diving to some therapeutic value for specific issues,
yeah.
I think you could probably talk to the organizations involved with those specific issues and maybe get some support, strategic partnerships.
Yeah, and we love that. So that's definitely something I would like to do around in this area as well.
Working in any of the hospitals or any of those groups get involved in them, that'd be great. A quick question. Actually, a two-part question. Is there any research to back up whether this helps PTSD, whether that therapy helps PTSD? And two, have you heard of rock bottom, try to trap up in that meeting they're doing some of this type of work with veterans as well?
So with PTSD, that one's we do work with divers with PTSD. That one is a little bit more challenging one. So I don't have a lot of specifics on cases where we've really been beneficial, but I can definitely go back and take a look at that. There are a few organizations that do this. I don't know about rock bottom, but there are a few kind of throughout. This local area as well as in the U.S. I think what's unique about us is we've got a national and global presence. We've developed that, so the ability to do those international trips and stuff is probably something that we are able to do a little bit more easily than some of these other organizations. And the other thing that's different about us is this is we're our own certified agency, and a lot of those will use adaptive version of an SDI. I think there's a few basic ability. There's a couple of certifications out there. And what our founder found is he was actually teaching the HSA, the Handicap Food Association material. And he found that they were not comprehensive enough and they didn't require enough practical experience for the certification. And this is why we developed this. And we worked with many agencies to do that. Our training to become a buddy lasts 4 days in the water. Not all day other agencies will do that. And we basically have people in the water doing all the skills. If you're a diver, you know all the skills that you do to become an open water diver, blindfolded. We do all of it with your legs bound and then like a paraplegic. We do it where we make you become a quadriplegic and you're trusting someone else to actually do everything for you. So those are the types of things that we do, and I don't know, I haven't gone through their programs, how the other organizations do it, but I think what we do in terms of providing that type of empathy training is pretty special.
What is your personal background and what made you choose to join this organization?
I'm a Accenture consultant. I don't know if you guys know what that organization is, but it's a big, large consulting firm. I was with them for almost 20 years. And I did consulting in healthcare, so I worked in the healthcare space, doing mostly process re-engineering work and system implementation. And I used to say I burnt out. out. It was a hard life. And so I am taking some time off. And I've been a scuba diver since I was 2001. And then I had my friend actually is the executive director of this organization. She's like, I have this organization. I said, great. You should get involved. And my passion is that I love working with children. She got me involved, and the rest is kind of history. I really love doing this. It's so rewarding. I'm super excited about what we're doing tomorrow with our six kids in the pool. So, you know, it's great. And I'm lucky that I have the ability to do this, you know, taking them off really, so, and give them back.
Okay. Could you tell us a little more about
our founder? Okay, so our founder, his name is Jim Elliott. He is Googleable, and he's done a few TED Talks. He was a media ad exec. He retired before he started this. And the reason he did it was his daughter was blind from birth. She was always consistent that she was normal like everybody else. But as you get older, it becomes harder. So around the time she was in middle school or high school, they found a program where they did downhill skiing. And he was doing that with her, and he's a scuba diver, and he said, well, they can do that and make, you know, such an impact on a girl who, you know, couldn't visually see by doing skiing. Well, then why can't we do this with diving? And so he started Diveheart, this kind of small organization. Really ran programs out of Chicago, and then they just kind of started training people, and then it started getting bigger and bigger, and then he started realizing some of the flaws in the existing programs, and that's why he started building our own certifying program in the fall.
Thank you so much for volunteering
your
time and sharing this very organization with us. What is it that we as a woman community can do for you?
Okay, great. So right now in this area, we don't have a pool facility that we can use. And so one of the big things that I'm looking for is a pool facility, a private community that we can actually host events and training and do training at. The other is access to service and other not-for-profit organizations, like you mentioned. You know, other organizations that might benefit, that might be interested, that might either have people who would love to volunteer or have people who would really benefit from being in the water being in our programs. And then volunteers. I already, I think, did my little pitch for instructors. And then the other thing is equipment donation. So, you know, we have a lot of divers in Florida. If you dive frequently, you probably replace your equipment relatively regularly. And so if there is mass bins, things that you don't use anymore, you know, we appreciate all those. Those, you know, we're 5 and 6 of those donations can be written off.
Well, as is tradition, many people refill us their coffee. I don't regret any of you anything, but you're going to miss out on an exciting pitch for St. Petersburg Small Business Week.
Yay!
So, next week is our Small Business Week here, the City of the Chamber. We're doing a ton of stuff. I mentioned before, it kicks off here at 9 o'clock on Monday with kind of a proclamation, and we're going to do a ribbon cutting and give you guys a tour. We've redone the upstairs, if you wonder what the sounds are during 1 million tests. We'll all get to go see that. Wouldn't be a big event at the greenhouse without Kawa Coffee. They will be here as well. That'll be fun. That's our kickoff. Then all day Tuesday, a number of professionals and business folks from around Tampa Bay are coming together to host a series of workshops USF St. Pete Student Center. These are a really diverse range of topics, not the things you usually see, not the things you see here at the greenhouse regularly, everything from the power consumption of a small business to HR, some marketing tips. It is across the board, all free, drop into one, stay for the whole day, whatever it is your fancy. Then on Wednesday, we're going to have a special 1 million cups here. That'll be